Let us pray. Dear Father God, we come before your presence this night, thanking you for all your many blessings. We thank you so much for every Zoom listener, viewer, and caller. And we come to you lifting our hands in a high hallelujah praise because you sit it high and maketh the earth your footstool. And Lord Master, we just thank you so much for this privilege and honor to be able to study your holy and divine word. And we just come asking forgiveness for all of our sins and all of our transgressions. And on tonight, Lord, we ask that you bless us with the ability to understand content regarding whether it's verses, scriptures, visual aids, or short clips, to give an understanding to us to understand this subject matter that is pretty much has not been discussed. But Lord, we thank you for opportunities such as these, where we can go from Genesis to Revelation to understand that all your content is needed for the child of God to understand, to be ready, to be a prepared people for a prepared place. We praise you to the utmost, and we thank you, and we just come asking all of these blessings in Jesus Christ's name. We pray, amen. So again, it is truly a blessing to see each and every one of you tonight. And I can say, I know last Thursday, we were pretty much in a setting where we were, you know, in a hospital room, but you know, tonight, to God be the glory, we are able to be back healed by Jehovah Rapha, the Lord that healeth thee. So I'm just really excited tonight to be back because we go through many trials and tribulations, but I think the beautiful thing is when we have a faith that is able to move mountains, that's the key. And he basically said, all we need is the faith of a mustard seed. And a lot of us might be familiar with the mustard plant, but if you ever saw the size of the seed of the mustard plant, it's kind of astounding the results you can get from that small seed that produced such a large plant. So always be mindful. You only need faith of a mustard seed. If you got the faith of a softball or hardball, that's too much. That's why it's not working. We need to understand just the faith of a mustard seed. So I'm so thankful, and I want to give each and every one of you a gratitude of thanks for your prayers and your support that helped aided me through a speedy recovery. So I thank each and every one of you so much from the depths of my heart. Amen. So tonight, I remember last week we left off because I was trying to show you a video clip of a short example of what the rapture may look like. And tonight, if this is your first time here, it's okay, because what we try to do is give you enough information and content to bring you up to speed with such matters regarding the rapture. The rapture is God's redemption program for the church, the body of Christ, which is the bride of Christ. You remember when Jesus said, I go to prepare a place for you, and when I come again, I'll receive you unto myself. He was letting the believers know that you are my bride, and Jesus was in the fashion as the groom, because we have to be mindful that Jesus is the groom, and the whole body of Christ worldwide is the bride. So Jesus used the concept of the Jewish marriage customs, where the earthly groom would be engaged to his earthly wife. And what he would do, he would promise to her to take her away from her mother and her father, so she would stay at home with her parents while the groom goes away to build a new place for her. You see the similarity here? And Jesus is basically using the Jewish marriage custom construct, how he's going to actually come back for his bride. So you notice the bride stays at home with the husband and wife, which is the mother and father of the bride. You got that? So guess where the bride is now? We're at home on planet Earth, and we're waiting for our groom, Jesus, who's building a mansion. Remember he said, I'm going to prepare a place for you. And then he talked about In my Father's house are many mansions. And if it were not so, I wouldn't have told you. So you remember that part, right? So Jesus is actually doing what the earthly groom does in that custom. He's building mansions for his bride to be, which is us. And when that groom, when that mansion or home is ready, he would come halfway back. He would not come all the way back to the bride's home where she is. He purposely met her up on a hill while she was down low in the valley. And he would blow his horn, and the bride would come running out with her processional bridesmaids. All of them would come and meet him halfway. Then he would take the bride and the bridal party home to celebrate the wedding, which is the exact same thing we talk about the rapture. The rapture is the event where God is coming to take the bride away in the moment of a twinkling of an eye. Okay? So just in the twinkling of an eye, we shall all be changed. That's talked about in 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, verses 16 through 18. See, it's basically Jesus built this the same way. And the church will be gone, the bride will be gone for 7 years. And that's why tonight I want to go in a little bit more detail regarding what happens after the rapture. Okay? Because the bride will not be here, but those who are left behind will have to stay here for 7 years. 3.5 years is going to look like everything's all right. Then the latter 3.5 years, that's when the Antichrist is going to step on the scene. Even though the Antichrist is already in our public arena today, we just don't know who he is, but there's some speculation based on how he maneuvers and how he behaves himself and what things and agendas that are upcoming in today's society and world. So with that said, what we're going to do tonight, I'm going to leave off where I left off with the video that we was supposed to see last week, but some reason it didn't appear. So what I'm going to do tonight is I'm going to try to replicate and bring that to visual for us tonight. So give me a hot second while I fire this up. But other than that, how is everyone doing tonight?
Blessed.
All right, that's good. Blessed. I got a little worried because I didn't hear anything. I didn't know if anyone was napping or taking a sleep, or I didn't know if you probably watching your favorite football game on tonight. Yeah, there's some good stuff on. So we're on mute. Competition. All right, so good. Here we go. So let me fire this up for you. Okay, let's see. Click here. Wham. Okay, can you guys see this?
Yes.
Okay, you can see that? So what I'm going to do is fire it. I just want to make sure we can hear it. So let's do this.
You want to be in the rapture. You don't want to be left behind.
You hear that?
Yes.
Yes.
Oh, okay. So
you want to be in the rapture. You don't want to be left behind. Because the Bible is very clear. At the rapture, again, man, we get sucked up off this earth. We meet the Lord in the clouds, and all this baloney fades away. Mm-hmm. So right after the rapture, shortly thereafter, I don't know the exact date of that, but man, shortly after that, bang, God's wrath is going to be poured out on this planet for 7 years nonstop. You don't want to be here. Mm-mm. And so if you're not saved, you need to get saved right now. This is not a game. Mm-hmm. It might look something like this. We'll close in prayer after this. Thank you.
Okay. Well, what you think of what you saw?
What about Revelation 16, 18? I saw it on the screen, but in my Bible, it says something different.
It says the bowls of God's anger.
Well, the thing is, what you just saw was pretty much the after effects if you're left behind. I didn't really know if you saw how quick everybody left. Did you see that? And there are several events that transpired after the fact. This one kind of gave you a little bit more in detail of the wrath that will be happening that God is pouring out. They kind of showed it very quickly, but it's not going to be very quick like that. This is just for a video teaching purposes. Did you see when the man and his son was playing football catch, shoe fell out the ground? And various airplane parts came falling down, and very graphic. Really showed a train went off the track. Did you see the car run into something with nobody in it? So it's really a lot of content to be broken down, and I just wanted to make sure everyone was able to see it and hear it. So you guys were able to catch it? What I'm gonna do for you though, I'm gonna replay it, but I'm gonna break down certain sections and pause it so we can perhaps check some of this out very quickly. Anyone have any questions or comments?
Yes, I'd like to know somewhere we when we were studying it said that the people, some of the people that were left would be trying to commit suicide because they don't want to be here, but they're not going to be able to do that.
Correct. In other words, during this time period, many will try to take their life, but it says death will flee from them. You have to keep in mind, God knows they're not going to be able to withtake and withstand this. So he's going to make sure you're going to stay for it. In other words, you wasn't ready. Well, you're going to have to stay here till I get back, and we'll see if you make it. And a lot of people are really going to give in and get the mark of the beast. A lot of people don't know that the mark is actually being set up right in front of your face right now. A lot of us have these SIM cards in our debit cards, correct? You remember you used to slide it once upon a time. Remember you used to just slide it? Well, let's back it all the way up. You remember you used to place your card and they used to put it on this thing and go shh. And with the carbon pipe, carbon piece of paper, it would record your credit card information. We came along from that. Now we are swiping. And now you can tap. Y'all seen the tap?
We just now.
Well, many people don't know the distraction that they're going to say, is it possible? Would you like your SIM card chip on your credit card placed underneath your skin? And many are going to say, yes, I think that's great because now I don't have to keep my wallet. If somebody robbed me, they can't do anything. They have to cut my hand off or something. But the thing is, this is what's going. It's already started. It's already, Whole Foods already got a system going where you don't have to pay with your credit card anymore. You can go and they'll help you use the palm of your wrist or your hand and scan your hand and attach it to your debit card. Did y'all know that? This is already in front of you. So this is the game plan, and a lot of these things are going to come into play really after the rapture. See, they can't really do too much while God's people is here. The moment God's people is gone, did you see the little film clips or of the news broadcaster? They were trying to figure out and just say, oh, some kind of magic dust or some kind of nuclear made people vanish. Did you see that? That's because CNN, NBC, CBS, ABC, they're all going to be running around trying to figure out what happened to everybody. But you best believe there's a film clip is going to cut to somebody, and that somebody is going to be the Antichrist, and he's going to have an explanation for what happened. And it's going to sound very pleasing to everyone but the people who know better, who knew what just happened. It's going to sound very persuasive what he's going to say. But those who knew that they should have been ready already know what happened. They might say a UFO came and removed billions of people from the earth very quickly. And they're going to have a reason for it, but then the world is theirs now. They can do whatever they want with everyone now because they're going to be led astray, just like a lot of people have been already led astray by the first thing that happened 2 years ago.
Yeah.
You got a question, Ina? See your hand?
Excuse me. Good evening, everyone. Yes, Marvin, what you're saying as far as the chip, that's like a couple of weeks ago when I had texted you about this gentleman who has a Tesla. And what he did is he had a chip put in his hand under his skin. So he just has to run his hand over whatever portion of the car and it would unlock his door. And he said that about 3 years ago, mind you, 3 years ago, he did the same thing, had a chip put in his other hand for his front door to his house.
Okay.
So when I asked Marvin, he's like, this is what I've been talking about. And when I heard it, all I could think of was Marvin, because this is what Marvin has been telling us. And this was literally on Channel 5 News.
Yeah, I mean, I try to educate everyone in terms of biblical content to be able to see what's going on in the real world. See, you can know the word of God, but if you don't know what's going on in the world, what's the point? If you have the knowledge of the world, but then you don't have the word of God, you're still going to be unbalanced. You have to understand both concepts. Many people know the word, but they don't know what's happening out here. And that's where biblical prophecy comes in, because keep in mind, the Bible has 3/4 of that Bible is biblical prophecy. So that's letting you know that God wants to warn us, but he still wants us to be saved. Okay? Because you have to know why you're saved. Most people don't even know why they're saved and they're a born again Christian, I hope. What does it mean if a person say, I am saved? Can somebody tell me what does it mean if you say you're saved?
Born again.
We don't have to
live God's wrath.
From the wrath of God.
Yes. You are saved from God's wrath. In the film clip, you saw a little bit of what is to come. You see, we have a loving God, because everybody say God is love. He won't hurt a flea. Oh, yeah. They must haven't read the book of Revelation. See, they don't understand God's wrath is specifically poured out through the seven seals, through the seven trumpets, the seven bowl judgments. And he told John, don't even write about the seven thunders. So in the little film clip, you just saw a little bit, and I have one more for you. But what I'm going to do, I'm going to replay this one and just narrate a little bit what you're about to see. So we will kind of learn together, okay?
Okay.
So let me run this back one more time. So I'm going to just point out some things for you. And if you have any questions along the way, that's perfect too.
Give, man, we get sucked up off this earth. We meet the Lord in the clouds and all this baloney fades away. But right after rapture, shortly thereafter, I don't know the exact date of there, but man, shortly after that, God's wrath is going to be poured out on this planet for 7 years nonstop. You don't want to be here.
7 years.
So if you're not saved, you need to get saved right now. This is not a game.
Let me pause right there. That's a good word right there, that what the pastor said. If there is no one that is not saved right now, all you have to do is just unmute your phone, and we will lead you through the sinner's prayer. That's what it's called. And let me pause for the calls, because how can you say you're a Christian? And if somebody walk up to you right now and say, I understand you're born again, I watch you, your walk is amazing, and I see you holding your Bible, but is there a way you can help me be saved? And the question would be, does anyone on here know how to lead someone in a sinner's prayer? Oh my goodness, if you don't know that, we need some homework, Christian homework, because that is so vital, because this person wants to be saved. And you have to know how to help this person be saved. So the pastor on the television or the video clip is saying, if somebody needs to know Jesus right now, you can know him right now at this point. But we can wait again and address it at the end of the class. But I saw a hand. Was someone had a hand up? I saw. Okay. So I'm going to just play a little bit of this. Watch this.
It might look something like this. We'll close in prayer after this.
So right now, you can see that the sky is opening. Apparently, Paul says, at the sound of the last trump, the dead in Christ shall rise first, and those that are alive and remaining shall be caught up to meet the Lord in the air. But I have another beautiful video that I'm going to show you. It is slowed down, so slow, to show you what happens in the moment of the twinkling of an eye. So stay tuned. That one's coming up next, but we're just going to walk through this one very briefly. Not a lot of it, but just check it out. They're being lifted up just that quick. Y'all saw that? Look, they're leaving. See all them souls leaving? They're being escorted through the galaxy to the throne room where God is. So that's what's happening right here. See that? It's amazing. As they were leaving, y'all heard the screams and the car alarms going off, but as they got further away from the earth, it's peace and quiet. Look at that. Now it brought us back just to take a look at what's going to happen on the planet Earth now. So this is what's happening on the Earth right now. People are hollering, screaming. Look at that. Car, no one driving. You know why? Because the person who was driving must have left when the rapture, right? So here's a runaway car running into a tree of something. Look at this. Look at this one. Shoe falling from where? Airplane seat. Wheels from an airplane. Gotta run. Engine. You see, that is gonna be a rude day. Do you guys realize how many airplanes are flying in the sky? Mm-hmm. You can't really tell because, you know, they have to travel at approximately 32 to 45,000 feet up in the sky. And it's like a grand traffic highway up there. But oh, when that day, because you have to keep in mind, the air traffic controllers might, some of them might be raptured up. And ooh, let me put this in your pocket. Did you not know all airlines, they ask the preference of religion of their pilots? Let me explain to you why. Huh. They need to know what faith or religion you believe in. You know why? Because they want to make sure if you're a Christian, they know you are approximately maybe raptured. So they will leave one pilot of a different faith and a Christian in a pilot. How about that in the cockpit? I found that out. I had to research that. What you think of that? So every pilot, when you walk on a plane, I say, hello, how you doing? But I already know one of them in there is a believer and one maybe of a different denomination. Because just in case, they know. So that means the airlines know about this, what we're talking about. They know. You guys don't understand. People don't understand this rapture is going to happen. The word rapture is not in the Bible, but it's the term caught up. You see, caught up is the Greek word rapturo, where we get the English word rapture. Okay? It's meaning to be snatched away, to remove, dislocated to another location. Okay? So let me let you see a little bit more. This is the film part about the train that went off the track, and it's just going and going and going. So you already know, for this train to be moving, apparently the engineer must have been raptured because the train did never stop. It just kept going, right? Got a hand there.
Yeah, Marvin, I'm just curious. This might be a silly question. During the process of the rapture, people are going to be killed. You know, for unmanned cars, planes falling, different things. What happened to those souls?
Well, apparently, if they wasn't raptured before that, that's a question whether apparently they wasn't saved then, because they're still here after the fact.
So then they're not going to die, though.
Perhaps, yeah. Hmm. Because you saw the people in the car was in that accident. They were still here, remember?
That's true.
Car flipped over. They were still in there. It showed the train. People still alive on the train. Hmm. See that? So, yeah. Look at this. Still got a little bit more. People are running scared. Look at the news report. It says millions vanish. The Riri cry rapture. Experts purport gamma ray burst. So this is the foolish talk that you're going to see on the news, because they don't know. They don't read the Bible. But if you are a Christian, watch this. If you knew somebody told you about this and you failed to accept Christ in your life and you're sitting here looking at this, you're going to say, man, my mom told me. My dad told me, my wife told me, my husband told me, my boo told me, Ray Ray and them told me. Ain't that something? Ray Ray and them gone and you still here. See what I'm saying? I mean, you got to understand, this is serious. But these people that's still left here don't know. But look what the expert says. They said it was a purport gamma ray burst. Everybody leave. But they say some of the Riri cry rapture. You go hear this word so much after it happened?
Yes.
But what's the problem? You've been sitting in your church for 40 years and the pastor ain't said nothing. We hear about tithes and offerings, but we don't hear about the rapture. Mm-hmm. Look at this. Y'all see that right there?
Great tribulation.
Tribulation has begun. And my target next is to pretty much train and educate us a little bit more thoroughly what the tribulation is. Those of us who participated in the book of Revelation pretty much learned a lot, because we went from chapter to chapter, verse by verse, from chapter 1 all the way to chapter what?
22.
Oh, I like that. Y'all was there. Y'all knew all the way from chapter 1 to 22. And I know y'all probably could break the book down now, because it's one verse that pretty much tells you how to interpret the whole book for a proper interpretation. What verse is that in chapter?
Chapter 1, verse 19.
That's what I wanted to hear. Y'all take it to the Bible. Y'all better keep them notes handy. I might bust out some questions on you.
Okay.
So keep in mind, the Great Tribulation has begun. The tribulation period is a period. They call it Jacob's trouble. Oh, the book of Daniel, to me, represents the book of Revelation in the Old Testament, and the book of Revelation stands alone in the New Testament by themselves. Both of these two books go simultaneously together because Daniel had a dream, and that dream of the four beasts are those that are depicted in the book of Revelation. You guys understand the book of Revelation is perhaps, they say, one of the most misunderstood books, but when you take the time and go through it, it's a very beautiful book. It shows you who God is. It shows you how the angelic hosts function and praise God daily. And we can't even do it on Sunday for an hour and a half. We looking at our watches and clocks like, ooh, I got to get up out of here. Wait a minute. Did you not know that every Sunday is rehearsal, you guys? I can't make this any clearer. On last night, we have to let people understand that the church is not a location or a place. You are the church. Why do you think the letter U and the letter R is in the middle between CH and CH? And I'm not talking about CH sugar either. CH, you are CH. You are the church. So we need to stop acting like it's a place, a location, and you only go there on a day, because a lot of us, when we come there, we want to be holy, the look holy, the talk holy, the walk holy. And then all of a sudden, you leave there, and where did your halo go? Did it get stuck on the threshold on the way out the door? A lot of us come in here and be one way, then we leave out another. You are the church 24 hours a day, while you're asleep, while you're walking, while you're talking. When you over there with Shanae-nay-nim, hey, you still the church. You are it, okay? So that's what we talk about on Wednesday night. But the Great Tribulation is a time that you do not want to be a citizen on the planet Earth. You would want to be saved now because Jesus Christ died for you right now. You need to accept him right now because guess what? He died for you right now. But when you're in the tribulation period, guess what? You got to go die for him now. Oh, y'all see that? Mm-hmm. They say everything free we don't want. We want to pay for everything. Well, guess what? Salvation is a free gift and nobody want it. Some of the best things are free. A lot of us still like going to the 99 cent store, but will not accept Christ. Isn't that something? You know somebody right now in your house, work with, your friends, family, hope it ain't no spouse or whatever, but they too close to miss it. But guess what? I'm going to show you a film. That's why I'm going over this stuff week in, week out to prepare you, because I'm going to show you a film called The Sunday Morning Rapture. Basically, the title tells you that the rapture is going to happen on a Sunday, and you go see what people are doing on Sunday. Some go come, some not go come. Some go be getting ready, some go stay at home. It's going to be a lot of drama on this particular Sunday, and the Lord go come, because we don't know what day or the hour he's coming, but in this movie, he's coming on Sunday. And oh, it's going to be something to see who left in the pulpit.
Mm-hmm.
See, like the whole pulpit should be gone, right? Mm-hmm. They was telling you what to do, but I guess the pastor wasn't telling y'all how to get ready. See, pastors love telling you what to do, but they don't tell you how to get ready. And how to be ready. I know what I'm talking about, but oh my goodness. Let's see what else is going on. Uh-oh. Revelation 12:12. Woe to those who dwell upon the earth. Yeah, during this time, for the devil has come down to you having great wrath, because he knows he has only a short time left. During this passage in the book of Revelation, this is actually speaking on the latter 3.5 years, because Paul did say they will say peace and safety. He's talking about the first 3.5 years. Then he says sudden destruction coming upon him. That's the last 3.5. So be mindful when you hear the word tribulation. This is a period that you do not want to be here, because the rapture is taking place. The church, the spiritual body of the Christ is gone. No Christian will be here at this time. If you left, that's because I don't know what you were doing. Did you really truthfully accept him? Did you live the life that he wanted you to do? Did he tell you to do something and you failed to do it? Mm. Yeah. Let's see what else. Look at that. Live breaking news. They don't know what's going on. Did you not know when this day happened, you guys? 880 freeway, 80 freeway, 101, 580. It's going to be tons of cars on these highways, and you expect trying to get home? It's going to be a long day for you if you're left. You might as well start walking. You know how many tow trucks they going to need to get off 80? Let's use hypothetically. Let's just say you work in Emeryville. You left. Rapture happens. You stuck right there by university. You're trying to get to Hercules. Do you think you finna make it home with that traffic that's already right there from El Cerrito all the way to stretch the San Pablo Dam Road? Uh-uh. Oh, okay. Everybody gonna be walking.
Everybody walking.
Looking around, bewildered, trying to figure out what happened. Oh, but homeless people, watch this. If there are homeless people that knew Christ, they're not homeless anymore. They have a new home.
They're no longer homeless.
Okay. How about that? Isn't that something? Mm-hmm. They don't have to worry about a thing anymore. But you, who was driving that beautiful S550, it's sitting there, still running. Oh, that Tesla, still running. You left that thing. You didn't got out and walk. When you get home, you wondering, is my husband there? Is my wife there? She was telling me I need to come to church with her. I need to come to church with him. Woo, what about them children? That's unfair for any parent if you leave and leave your children here. Lord have mercy.
Oh, Lord.
Y'all better quit playing. These parents who know that's sitting here, but you got children at home, you want them to go with you, don't you?
Yeah.
You don't want your children to be left here 7 years with this stuff? The child gonna be like, man, my mom and all my father, they never mentioned this to me, but they're not here anymore. You guys, this is serious. I'm not sure. I'll probably need to tell somebody to be on here next Thursday. I don't know what to say to you. Look at this.
Planetary pole shit.
They still talking crazy. Look at this. Planetary pole shift. Planet X spawns global havoc. You guys need to cut it out. Geomagnetic storm. God's son came and got his bride. That's all that happened. That's all. That's it. See, a lot of strange storms and things are going to happen. You know what? Let me give y'all a hint. My Bible study teacher, Brother Homer Williams, back in 1993, he used to do this. He used to stand up in front of the class. He used to say, did y'all know Isaiah 24:1 says, the Lord is going to grab the earth like this? And he used to do this. Those of you on the screen can see what I did. Brother Homer used to stand right there by that chalkboard. He'd say, Isaiah 24. So if y'all want to go take a peek, go look what Isaiah 24:1 says. God says he's going to grab the earth like this, and Homer wouldn't say nothing. He'll just do this. So when you see the planet going through all this catastrophic stuff, that's Isaiah 24:1. What does that say?
Let's see.
Isaiah 24:1 says, behold, the Lord maketh the earth empty and maketh it waste and turneth it upside down.
What?
And scattereth and turneth it upside down and scattereth abroad the inhabitants thereof.
Oh, so God says he's gonna scatter everything on the planet and give it a good shaking. And y'all thought y'all was shaking and baking with y'all chicken mix. God go do the same thing to the planet Earth. Isn't that something?
Read chapter, part two.
No, that was it. That's all I needed was verse one. Thank you. Yep. So you guys got to be mindful that God is not playing. I don't know why we down here playing, but God is not playing. Do you realize the importance of why we're even going over this tonight? There are so many subject matters to talk about from Genesis to Revelation, but there is a reason right now at this appointed time that this lesson is going forth for a specific reason. That's because God wants somebody to be ready instead of getting ready. You know what? There's so much more to that little video, but I want you to see this one. Oh my goodness. This is 6 minutes, you guys. This one here is going to show you what the rapture will look like, slowed down on a detail account. Y'all ready for this one? Can you guys see this one?
Ready, yes.
All right.
Rapture of the
Rapture. The rapture of the bride. Here we go. Let's see what's going on here. He's coming outside looking. Hostage somewhere going on. Thank you. wanted to show you that first glow, that was the dead in Christ had risen first, okay? That's why these are those who alive and remaining shall be caught up to meet the Lord in the air. I just wanted to see if y'all caught that. Keep in mind, this is a slowed down version so you can see just a little bit an example what it looks like, okay? So they're gone. Body of Christ left. See that? They're coming home. Questions or any comments on what you've seen?
Right.
That was just an example how mm-hmm. Christ is going to unite with us. We're all mm-hmm. the bride. So always be mindful. The bride coexists. Every since Jesus emptied the tomb.
Mm-hmm.
See, there's a difference between the Old Testament saints until Jesus came and mm-hmm. emptied Abraham's bosom. Y'all got right. that? So mm-hmm. just like when you go to an earthly wedding, visitors of the bride is on one side.
Right. Mm-hmm.
Remember that?
Right.
You go
right.
to a wedding, visitors of the groom is on another side. So mm-hmm. guess what? The groom's visitors is everybody from the Old Testament.
Oh. Oh, okay.
So guess what? Any one of us who passes away now, they go to the other side and everyone just is kind of waiting around for the wedding to start.
Mm.
So that's why Paul said to be absent from the body is to be present with the Lord. No one needs to wait anymore in Abraham's bosom. That's why Jesus taught the parable of Lazarus. The mm-hmm. account, in other words, he gives you the account of what happens in the afterlife to people who died trusting in the Messiah and those mm-hmm. who didn't trust in the Messiah. See that? Mm-hmm. You always had to accept someone. You can't just walk around here and say you don't know. Anybody in the Old Testament, they died trusting in the Messiah or not. So when Jesus comes, you either believe and trust in Jesus Christ or not. You either accept him or not.
You need to reject him.
So that means you are a candidate that is waiting to be the bride. But in the meanwhile, if we depart sooner before the rapture, you basically are escorted into the sanctuary and everybody just kind of mingle until the bride comes to the wedding. Y'all see how this thing is working now?
Mm-hmm.
I'm trying to make sure the wheels is spinning so we can get the understanding what's happening down here with life and death.
Mm-hmm.
Any of our fathers, mothers, grandparents, sons, daughters, cousins, friends, when anyone passes away right now, they are escorted and they walk into this room where the marriage of the supper of the Lamb is going to be. There's another wedding about to happen. The bride is the one that's not ready. That's why when you go to an earthly wedding, none of them don't start on time, because who's not ready? The bride is not ready, right?
All right,
if it's something with the shoe, the dress, hair, mm-hmm. hairpiece. I don't know what's going on. I don't know what's mm-hmm. not ready. Why is she not ready? But guess what? Today, the real bride is still not ready, because there are still people who have not accepted Christ yet.
Uh-huh.
So believe me, when you hear that mm-hmm. horn blow and when you start people looking up, mm-hmm. you best believe the wedding is getting ready to start.
Mm-hmm.
Okay? That means she ready now. Yes, I see a hand. Ease now. Mm-hmm.
Sorry, I'm on mute. So I just want to clarify.
Yeah.
So people who died are where?
In God's presence.
In God's presence, yes.
Because okay. Paul said there to be absent from the body is to be present with the Lord. So they're present with him, but in the area where the marriage of the Lamb will take place.
And is that is in a place in heaven?
Correct.
Okay. Sorry. I just want to be clear, because it's confusing sometimes, because when they say, well, the Bible says the dead in Christ shall arise first. And I've always assumed that to be people who have died and who are buried, as has been, you know, shown in some of your videos. Those people rise first, and then us who are left on the earth. But if they're already with God in heaven, mm-hmm. that confuses me sometimes.
Yeah, what's happening is, you remember when anyone passes away, their body is left here. So that means basically their soul went to be with God, but the body stays here. But okay. when that time comes, just like Jesus had to come back and get his body, the person that's with him has to come back and get their body.
Okay.
Because okay. if you're alive here, you didn't die. So you didn't need to have a funeral for a casket or urn. You see, that's the whole point to life. This body that was created, it is to be used, because Jesus, when he died at Calvary, his body was placed in the tomb, but his spirit went down. In Ephesians 4:8 says, he not only did he ascend, but he descended down into the lower parts of the earth first to lead those who were captive unto captivity. What that is saying is, before Jesus showed up, everybody waited in a place called Abraham's bosom. Mm-hmm. If you died trusting in the Messiah in the Old Testament, you was on this side, which was Abraham's bosom, and there was a gulf between it. And if you didn't believe in the Messiah, you was on this side. So okay. what happened was, Jesus came and emptied this side where all the Old Testament saints were and took everybody with him. And that's why Jesus had to come back and get his body. Remember, and he appeared to the disciples.
Got it.
Remember, Thomas said, I didn't believe it. So he said, touch and feel me. The only reason why Jesus came back, because he wanted to let us see that we're going to coexist one day with people in the flesh and people in the spirit. whenever you come to the planet Earth, you need a body, because if not, we won't know who you are.
Mm-hmm.
See, the cosmetic structure of everyone that we see is the DNA chromosomes of our parents, our mother and our father. That's what make up the shell of who we are. But no one has never seen the real Ejanea. No one has never seen the real Gerald. No one has never seen the real Sonia. They just looking at the exterior package. So when it's time to come back, we have to come get that body to bring it back. But that's why the Bible says flesh and blood cannot inherit. That body got to stay here. But you will receive a new body. Philippians says you're going to receive a new body just like Jesus Christ did.
Yes.
So that's why when it says in the dead in Christ shall rise first, they're with him just like Jesus was in heaven, but he had to come back and get his body, so everybody else got to come back and get theirs. Then we're going to go to the wedding reception.
Mm-hmm.
Just want to make sure we got it. Anything else?
No, that makes total sense.
Okay, sis.
Okay.
Any other questions or any comments? Anything?
Remember what Jesus said to the thief when he was on the cross.
Oh, you said this day.
Today, thou shalt be with me in paradise.
That's right.
So wherever those paradises is where those spirits are.
That's waiting, where the soul is. That's right.
Waiting to be caught up with Jesus at that particular time.
Right. So that's the importance when, let's say if Jesus wasn't on the cross and this particular thief that apparently he believed.
Yes.
He would have went to Abraham's bosom and would have to wait. That's the thing. Before Jesus showed up, everybody had to wait. That's why John 3:16 says, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son, begotten. That word begotten means firstborn from the dead. Yes. See, everybody had to wait until Jesus got there. When Jesus got there, now we can come before the Father. Nobody wasn't going nowhere. You have to wait.
Mm-hmm.
So that word begotten is very important. That word begotten means firstborn from the dead, meaning God's son had to raise to fix this before we can enter in God's presence. I see Sister Ellen got a question.
Hello.
Hey.
I just wanted to comment on what Sister Lillian had mentioned about those that want to commit suicide.
Mm-hmm.
And just that those people, to me, my understanding, that wanted to commit suicide was doing the bold judgment and the breaking of the seals and that time, because it would be, God will release his judgment with sickness, with pain, and these will affect the people on earth directly. Mm-hmm. Not what's going on around them, but their bodies. Mm-hmm. So when this is happening to the people and they are being, the judgment of God is upon them directly, then it's just like someone is sick. They want to commit suicide. And at that time, during the last 3 years, during his judgment, they can't. They will not be able to. They will not die.
Correct.
So I just wanted to kind of clear up what she had heard about people trying to commit suicide. It's mainly during that time because their bodies is what's attacked.
Correct. And people really going to be trying to do stuff to themselves, because a lot of people. Now, let's look at this for an example. When this stuff happened 2 years ago, y'all heard a lot of people was committing suicide because of the stuff with the virus and all that stuff. So they couldn't even take that. So you can imagine what's going to happen when the church is gone or when the rapture takes place. People are going to lose their mind. People are going to be like, man, I just saw my husband in the kitchen. He not here. Where did he go? That's going to mess people up. And I'm going to show you a film of what's going to happen, reenacting how people go be acting. So that's what I'm trying to do, is prepare us before we watch the film So you'll be able to know exactly what's going on, what's happening, the effects, the dialogue, the conversations between these families and their children and spouses and stuff. It's going to be very interesting for you to see. So I think what I'm going to do, any other questions or comments? Anyone else have anything? Before we wrap up tonight? Yes.
Good evening, everyone. I just wanted to make reference also about, you mentioned the fact that, and it's true that God will not allow us to go through the tribulation. And I believe you referenced this at one point during the study. I just wanted to make reference to 1 Thessalonians, the 5th chapter, the 9th verse. Mm-hmm. So if anybody ever asks you where he saved you from, it clearly indicates in that for God hath not appointed us to wrath, but to obtain salvation by our Lord Jesus Christ. That scripture specifically points to the fact that the saints, the believers, and Jesus Christ, the Christians, will be saved from the tribulation.
That's correct. Because we have to understand, you are saved from God's wrath. He has a plan, so you do not have to be here. But a lot of people, you know, these churches, these pastors need to tell the truth to their congregations. They need to be getting these people ready. They don't even understand how close we are. Very close. They supposed to be paying attention to the worldly signs and events. But I get it. We too busy doing other things. You need to be ready instead of getting ready. Because in that film, you go see the pastor told him. It's kind of funny that the main pastor left and the other ones were still, I'm not even going to say anything. You'll see this. It's going to be very nice. And I'm not going to show it this Thursday because I got one more class. I'm going to go very detailed with what the tribulation is. I'm going to spend probably 45 minutes educating us on what the tribulation period is. If you want a bird's eye view to do some homework a little bit, if you wanted to look from Revelation chapter 6 all the way to Revelation chapter 19, that will give you a thorough understanding of what the tribulation period is. You don't want to be here for it. This is the period that people have went and read the book of Revelation and gotten so frightened that they said, "Ooh, I don't want to read it." But they didn't realize what you're reading. If you're born again Christian, you won't be here what you're reading. So what you scared for? Don't need to be scared, because the problem is you need to read it so you can tell your wife, tell your husband, tell your children, tell your friends, tell your coworkers, tell your boo, whatever going on. I don't know. You need to tell somebody how serious this is. The Bible even talks about you need to scare some people into heaven if you got to. Go ahead and scare them on in, because if you want to sit around here, eat, drink, and be merry, go right ahead. Turn up. Well, watch this. You can turn up all you want, because Isaiah 24:1 says God's going to turn it up too. So if you know what you're doing, you will want to get ready instead of, oh, man. Any other questions or comments before we have a closing prayer and get ready to serve our communion tonight? Making good timing.
Pastor Saucer.
Uh-huh.
Blessed blessing. May I say, you asked about the sinner's prayer.
Wait, say that again?
You said someone would say the sinner's prayer.
Oh, I just wanted to make sure that every Christian on this call knows how to do it. And if they are not clear how it will go, I will actually... Okay, well, go ahead then.
Praise God. Really, it's like the sinner's prayer. Lord Jesus, I am a sinner. I need you to come into my heart. I confess with my mouth, believe in my heart that Jesus died on the cross, buried in a borrowed tomb. On the third day, Jesus rose then I would ask, now, where is the Lord Jesus now? It's a blessing if the person who I witnessed to would say he's in my heart.
All right, perfect.
That's my understanding.
Oh, that's perfect. John,
really, Romans 10:9. Yes.
Absolutely, because Romans 10:9 is basically enforcing what Proverbs 16:1 says. It says, for it is the preparation of the heart in man, and the right answer from the tongue is of the Lord. So God wants to make sure your heart is right before you say anything. See, a lot of times we say stuff that the heart didn't even confirm. And that's why your tongue and your mouth got you caught up writing checks that your life can't cash. See, you got God want to talk to the heart first. See, your mouth will say anything. But the Proverbs 16:1 is the perfect antidote to make sure that it's the God preparing your heart before you say something. See, a lot of us say it, but the heart didn't confirm it yet. So that's the key element to Romans 10:9. And when you lead them in that prayer, you have to also make sure you insert the forgiveness of sins. And you make sure you say, repeat after me, these words. So anyone else have any questions or comments before we close up and get ready to serve communion tonight? Anything else?
Good lesson.
Thank you so much. All right, we did it. I couldn't have did it without you guys. To God be the glory. So let us pray.